Truth Frequency Radio Network. KTFRN. Worldwide.
Shadowland Voyagers, in the spirit of sovereignty and self-empowerment, we invite you to journey with us into the Shadowland. Let's rediscover, reclaim, and integrate the fragmented aspects of our individual and collectively held consciousness. Realize true freedom and restore authentic expression. Could it be the only way out is through the Shadowland?
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Shadowland Voyagers. This is Sienna Leah, and I'm here with my co-hosts, Christina Grant. Christina, are you here?
Yeah. Yes, I'm here. Good evening, everyone.
And Elizabeth Hansen.
Good evening, everyone.
And with our special guest, Paul Levy. Paul, do we have you on the line?
Yeah, I'm actually right here.
Perfect. Paul, I have to say that you have been a great hero of mine for many years, and I feel so honored and privileged to be with you tonight. I feel that you are a great trailblazer for all of us, that you've been able to articulate to humanity an aspect of what is plaguing humanity that few have been able to articulate, and it has cost you your entire life. You've gone through huge battles to do this, and I really want to honor you for the place that you hold for us all.
Wow, I'm kind of speechless. I really appreciate that, so thank you very much.
I'm going to dive into your bio now, Paul, in this first 5 minutes, and then we'll go to break, and we will explore after the break this wonderful book. And I understand it's a book launch that is coming January 15th in 2 days, the Dispelling Wetiko, which is a great event for all of us. So I'm going to read the bio now. Born in 1956, Paul Levy grew up in Yonkers, New York. In the mid-70s, he went to college at what was then called the State University of New York at Binghamton. I hope I'm pronouncing that way. Now called Binghamton University, receiving degrees in both economics and studio art. While an undergraduate at Binghamton, he was hired by Princeton University to do research in economics. When he graduated college, he stopped his studies in economics and pursued his career in art, moving out to the Bay Area, where he was both making and teaching art. In 1981, due to an intense personal trauma, he had a life-changing spiritual awakening in which he began to recognize the dreamlike nature of reality. During the first year of his spiritual emergence, Paul was hospitalized a number of times and was told he was having a severe psychotic break from reality. Much to his surprise, he was diagnosed as having a chemical imbalance and was informed that he had manic depressive bipolar illness, that he would have to live with his illness for the rest of his life. Little did the doctors realize, however, that he was taking part in a mystical awakening shamanic initiation process, which at times mimics psychosis, but in actuality was a spiritual experience of a far different order, completely off the map of the psychiatric system. Fortunately, he was able to extricate himself. Shadowland Voyagers. This is Sienna Leia. And again, I'm here with Paul Levy, an extraordinary trailblazer for helping us understand the epidemic of evil that we are currently under siege. Paul, I understand that you again have this book launch in 2 days, and we want to spend most of the interview diving deep into that. But I would like to start with you. You have written in one of your articles, when I was first introduced to the world of psychiatry in May of 1981, at 24 years of age, I experienced a particularly unique synchronistic event that rocked my world and changed my life forever. I burst onto the scene of psychiatry in a dramatic way as a life-transforming event happened within the first minute of my being admitted to my very first psychiatric hospital. Would you be open to sharing with us what transpired then and what it birthed in you from that point on?
Sure, that would be my pleasure. But first, I want to just create a little bit of context. So, in other words, I'm an only child, and it wound up, I didn't know it then, but my father was a very sick man. He was a real psychopath, but, you know, it wasn't diagnosed. And I, being the only child, I was the recipient of him acting out his own, you know, his own darkness and his own abuse. So it created this enormous suffering for me. And I was dealing with the suffering. I quickly figured my way out that I couldn't figure my way out of my suffering with my mind. So I was dealing with my suffering by just observing what was happening. And that was really the only thing that was making me feel better. So I was really just doing this meditation, which is what that is when you're just in the witness state of just, you know, for probably close to 2 years, I was just hours and hours a day just sitting in meditation. And then one day, I got hit by a bolt of lightning, but not from the sky, but inside of my brain, this lightning bolt just ignited. And within 24 hours, I went into this extreme altered state. And the experience that I was having was that I was beginning to recognize that we were having a mass shared dream. And I was really kind of very ecstatic about that and very, you know, just excited and enthusiastic. You know, just, I should point out the word entheos. It means etymologically to be filled with spirit. So I was basically acting unlike my ordinary self. And so a friend of mine, I was in the Bay Area. This was May 1981. A friend of mine who was visiting from the East Coast thought I was having this breakdown. And so he brought me to a hospital. And I remember they brought me by ambulance. It was to Highland Hospital in Oakland, California, May 1981. And they bring me into the psych ward, and in the very first room, and I'll never forget this, is a woman. You know, there were all the psychiatric patients, and then there was a woman, and she was blind. You know, her eyes were completely opaque with no luminosity or radiance or anything like that. And I just felt incredibly just, I just felt this draw to her, and I just went right up to her, and I began looking in her eyes, and as if I was given a script to say, like I was channeling these words, they just fell in my head. I began spontaneously saying to her, all you have to do to see is open your eyes and look. And I just kept on saying those words again and again, getting closer and closer to her, just all the while I was looking at her eyes. The whole thing took not even a minute. And by the end of that minute, she had regained her sight and her eyes had become these normal, healthy, seeing eyes. And at that moment, as if it was choreographed, the doctors came and they took me and they strapped me up on a bed in another room. And that's where I spent the night, strapped up on this bed. And I knew I was having a spiritual, some sort of spiritual experience. I mean, it's pretty obvious when I just had that experience with the blind woman, which I was contemplating. And I, you know, it was just really obvious to me that I was, you know, beginning to wake up. I was seeing the dreamlike nature of this universe. And so then I began thinking of more and more people, and I was imagining, oh, the more people I thought of, the more people I could actually, in a way, bring along on my awakening. So I began thinking about, you know, just not only everybody I knew, but all beings. And I just was imagining that I was bringing all beings with me on my awakening. So then, to complete the story, the next morning, they unstrapped me, and they put me in a room, and I'm sitting at this table, and the only other person in the room is this ex-blind woman, and she's staring at me or she's not. She's just, you know, kind of we're staring at each other, and she has a big smile on her face, and she's not saying anything to me yet. And all of a sudden, my heart chakra just blossomed. And at that point, I had the recognition, oh, I get it. Her eyes were physically fine, but inwardly, sort of like in her psyche, she wasn't letting herself look. And somehow I kind of intuited that or saw that in some sort of clairvoyant way or something. And then I had the realization, oh, wow, it was like she was at the point in her process of being, she was ready to heal her blindness. And I was the one sent in, like, you know, to say whatever, you know, these particular lines that were the thing that were going to sort of help her to like step out of her hysterical blindness and to heal her eyes. And then she says to me the only words she ever said to me, to my knowledge, she says, aren't you going to answer the phone call? And she meant from, and she mentions my father's name. And then within like 10 seconds, the nurse comes in the room and says, Paul, your father's on the phone. Because my parents had just gotten the phone call that I, their only child, me, had just evidently had a psychotic break. And so I got out of that hospital after 3 days because the doctor in charge of me convinced me. He said, look, you know, you have to prove to us that you're not crazy and we're going to keep you here for a really long time. And I didn't really care that I was there because I was in such a surrendered, let-go state. But I thought about that and I thought, well, I actually don't want to really stay here that long. So I began, I just totally forced myself down and began talking about my problems and my whatever. Just, you know, I stepped into my ordinary state of mind and he let me out. And we got together for lunch the next week, the doctor and I, and he told me the fact that I was able to do that, that I was able to be fluid between the states and step into my ordinary identity, that was proof to him that I wasn't crazy. And I told him about the blind woman, but he got very uncomfortable and couldn't talk about it and, you know, said, oh, patient confidentiality. And to just kind of complete the story, when I got out of that hospital, all of my friends were convinced I had had like this nervous breakdown, but I knew something had happened. So I found out about, there was a Buddhist monk from Southeast Asia living in San Francisco. I went to see him, told him what had happened with the blind woman. He says, you're in luck. The greatest Buddhist master of all of Burma, at that point he was an 85-year-old master, was in town starting a monastery, and I should go and get his blessings, and I did, and we deeply connected. And that was the start of a whole new phase in my life from that point on. And during that next year, probably 3, 4, 5 other times, I got thrown in hospitals and diagnosed, and because I was having this full-blown spiritual awakening, but I wasn't in an ashram or a monastery. I wasn't in a container. I was just out in the world, and it was so unrestrained, or I was so unrestrained or uncontained, that I was really, you know, kind of triggering people and freaking people out and scaring people. And they didn't, you know, they didn't know what to do with me except institutionalize me and pathologize and diagnose. And the more that happened, the sicker I got.
Yes, of course. Because you needed, we might want to mute our mics so we're not talking. We do get some feedback here. We haven't been able to solve the problem, so I apologize for that. Yes, because you were having this huge spiritual awakening, and of course the Wetikos out there had to shut it down so they could eat your energy and bring you back to the matrix.
Yeah, that's exactly right. That's a very good way of describing it.
Okay, wow. Wow, Paul, that's just incredibly moving. I had a similar experience, and I know that people are actually all over the planet. There's a mass amount of this going on right now. It's so incredible that you survived that through the incredible abuse of the jailers of the medical establishment. So was this part of what helped you to perceive this level of evil that as you're opening to love and to compassion?
You know, I'm so glad you say that, because between, you know, the level of evil, because my father in a way was, in a, you know, I didn't realize it then, I didn't have the language, but he was taken over by Wetiko, or that's how I say it. It's not one way, it's not better than the other. But you know, then the thing with the psychiatric system, I was realizing, oh my God, here I had this encounter with this blind woman, and now I was encountering like this blindness on a system-wide scale in psychiatry. and it almost killed me. I was really fortunate to get out of the whole psychiatric system with my sanity intact, but it destroyed my family. Both of my parents died completely having bought into the psychiatric diagnosis. And so I'm still, it's been, you know, so many years later, and I'm still unpacking the incredible, like, grief and rage that I feel towards psychiatry. You know, just it's an unbelievably toxic system. And, you know, and I'm talking about in the early 80s where, you know, it was like Stone Age back then. They didn't have any recognition of even a phenomena called spiritual awakening or emergence or whatever. So, yeah, it was, you know, it was a difficult thing. And I was fortunate to get out of it with my life, basically.
You really were. I mean, what a story. My goodness. You are healing the blind. And what an incredible gift you gave to that woman while they're demonizing you and torturing you in that way. It's this is certainly a canvas to paint the epidemic of worldwide evil that you talk about, and which I would like to jump into.
Sure.
As well now. So then how did you come to discover this word Wetiko?
Sure.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And so, the world.
Uh-huh. Yeah, so what happened basically, so in my first book, the one is called The Madness of George W. Bush, a Reflection of Our Collective Psychosis, I coined this phrase malignant egophrenia, or ME disease, and it's a psychospiritual disease of the soul, which has to do with a misidentification of who we think we are. And I was realizing, oh, well, George Bush was, in a way, the incarnation of this disease, that we actually dreamed him up. If this is a mass shared dream, that all of us are like having a co-dream. We're co-dreaming, and at that point, you know, Bush, up to actually reveal and incarnate our own madness, our own ignorance. And like I said, I was calling it, you know, malignant egophrenia. And then I had realized, as I was in the middle of the book, that the indigenous people had been tracking this exact same psychospiritual disease of the soul, whose origin is the human psyche, and who and that operates through the unconscious and through the blind spots. And it's interesting, there's that blindness again. And they called it Wetiko. And I realized, oh my God, that's the same thing that I was actually in my book talking about, you know, calling it malignant egophrenia. And how I actually really discovered it personally was, so here my father had wound up that he was, you know, a genuine, like this world-class psychopath. But the thing which was interesting to me is that I was the one in the family system who was seeing his shadow and was pointing at it, but I didn't have language for it like I do now. I hadn't developed a fluency, but what I couldn't believe was how I had become the identified patient. And by pointing out this shadow that was operating through my father, I became the one who was seen as the one who was crazy. And I became the one who was seen as evil. And I realized, oh my God, there's like a non-local field that's actually informing what is actually happening in you know, the world and in my family system. And not only my family system, but even the psychiatrist and the mental health system, they all configure themselves to support the abuser. And I was realizing, oh my God, it's like here's this process that's actually hiding the light while at the same time it's revealing something. It's showing us the light. It's showing us that there's something, you know, in this process of protecting the abuser, that's actually showing us and introducing us to what I call the non-local field. And I should just give a definition. When I say like the non-local field, non-local is a physics term, which basically means that it doesn't abide by the third dimensional laws of third dimensional space and time. So when something has like a non-locality to it, it's not bound by those particular laws of the third dimension. And so it's very much like a dream, that it's very synchronistic. So in other words, what I was beginning to realize that right as like the darkness was getting exposed, the field would configure itself in a way to protect the abuser or hide the darkness. And that was actually playing out in my personal life, and it could have destroyed me. It could have driven me crazy, except for the fact that I was taking notes and I was making maps of it, and I was realizing, oh my God, that I'm onto something here. This is really, really important. And so, yeah, so basically psychiatry was one of the mediums or channels through which, and not only through which, but actually it's given me an incredible authority, the fact that I went through the ordeal I did to author a book on the nature of evil and how to break the spell, because it's very much of the nature of a spell.
Wow. Could you? I'd like to hear how you are correlating a spell with the nature of the Wetiko. That's a really interesting.
Mm-hmm. Sure. Yeah, yeah. Well, one thing, you know, for example, I think of the power of the word in the Bible. Like, first was the word, and the word was with God. And so there's something about the power of the word. And how do you make a word? You spell it, right? And so, so one way of understanding, like, what Wetiko is, so it's a form of psychic blindness where the person so afflicted, and keep in mind we all potentially have it. If we think, oh, that person has Wetiko and we don't, then we've fallen under its thrall right at that moment, because we're creating polarization. Where the idea is that it's a disease of consciousness itself. It exists in the collective unconscious, and what that means is that we all potentially can fall prey to it, okay? And so it operates through the projective tendencies of our mind. So to the extent we're always projecting, think about it. This is a dream. What is a dream but a projection? So we're always connecting the dots on the inkblot. And the way, when you think about how a dream works, if you hold a particular, you know, point of view in the dream, which is not separate from your own psyche, if you hold a viewpoint, that dream has no choice but to spontaneously shapeshift and reflect back your perspective. And that happens in no time. It happens outside of time. It doesn't take linear time for that to happen. That happens faster than you can blink or think. And so, but then you have a particular viewpoint here in a dream. The dream will reflect back that viewpoint, and you just assume, oh, now I have evidence to confirm my viewpoint. I have seemingly objective evidence, which makes you even more entranced into that viewpoint. So you see even more through that lens, which makes it even more manifest that way because it's just a reflection. Now, I was just describing in a dream, but I'm saying that same process is operative in the waking dream, okay? Now, the thing about Wetiko, it operates through the unconscious. So when somebody has fallen prey to Wetiko in any given moment, they will actually, they'll have a particular unconscious energy that they will express, or they'll embody or carry a particular unconscious energy, and with other people who are also having fallen under the spell of Wetiko in similar ways, it'll reinforce each of their shared unconscious blind spots, in a sense that they'll actually get into collusion or into alignment with each other, reinforcing and supporting each other's part of them that's mad. And when you have not just two people, but a group of people, that's a collective psychosis. And that's what Wetiko is. It's literally a collective psychosis that is completely happening all throughout our planet through our species. But we're so in the middle of it that you hardly hear any people even talking about that we're in the middle of a psychic epidemic, because our insanity has seemingly become like so normal.
Welcome back to Shadowland Voyagers. We're here tonight with Paul Levy, author of Dispelling Wetiko. Paul, I'm wondering if you can talk about how shadow aspects not only create susceptibility to Wetiko, but also the perfect breeding ground as well.
Sure. No, that's a great question. And because from the psychological point of view, the inner sort of, one could say, process that underlies Wetiko is projecting the shadow. And the way that works is that if we're not in touch with our own shadow, with our own darkness, what happens? We split off from it, and it gets projected outside of ourselves. Now, one way to understand what happens is think about a dream. And if you aren't associated with a part of yourself and you project it outside in a dream, well, what is the dream but your own mind, just, you know, as a reflection? So then into the dream will walk a figure who's embodying the very shadow that you've disassociated from, and they'll be incarnating and carrying that shadow. And if you don't have the recognition of that they're just an embodiment or an actual reflection of your own shadow, you then react to it, you know, as if it's objective and separate from you, when you typically try to destroy this, that person who's carrying that shadow, which itself is a reflection of the initial impulse of shadow projection in the first place, where we actually are trying to get rid of our own shadow. And so then you try to destroy the shadow as it manifests outside of yourself. But by doing that, paradoxically, you become possessed by the very shadow, by the very evil that you're seeing out in the world and you're wanting to destroy. So that's really, you know, a very simple way of understanding, you know, how the actual, you know, sort of our relationship to our own darkness and how we tend to project out the shadow is actually at the very bottom and informing and giving shape to Wetiko. Because Wetiko doesn't actually exist as an objectively, you know, existing entity. One way of thinking about it is like this germ, or like a mind virus, or like a tapeworm, or a parasite, or like a vampire. But it doesn't exist objectively at all, separate from your own consciousness. So on the one hand, it has no existence, and on the other hand, it can destroy our species. And what that's pointing to is the incredible power, intrinsic, that we all have inside of ourselves. Okay?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And I find that the beauty of it, though, is that it shows us exactly where these shadow aspects are hiding. So this presents us with an incredible opportunity. Can you talk about that, how Wetiko contains both the poison and the medicine?
Right. It's so great. That, I mean, just the fact that you would say that makes me so happy, because that's one of the major themes of my book, that here encoded in Wetiko, it's very much quantum. And by quantum, what I mean is, like, think about what is the, like, if you have, like, if you contemplate the nature of light, well, is light, is it a wave or a particle? And the answer is that it depends how you observe it. Mm-hmm. Same thing with Wetiko, is that on the one hand, it is the deepest evil that one can ever even have an imagination of. And simultaneously superposed in that Wetiko energy is its own medicine, that it's an incredible blessing that could potentially help us to wake up to the dreamlike nature. And whether it will manifest as this incredible toxin or evil or poison that will destroy our species, or whether it will wake us up, that all depends on how we going to dream it. That the responsibility and the choice is really up to us.
Mm-hmm. It's kind of a slippery fish, because on one hand, you need to recognize it, so bring your awareness to it, but you also don't want to engage with it too much and therefore feed it.
Right. That's a really important point, because I know a lot of very well-intentioned, you know, spiritual people who don't want to put any of their energy on evil, don't even want to talk about it, don't even want to mm-hmm. think about it, because, oh, I don't want to invest my energy in the darkness. But what they don't realize is that if they're actually in avoidance of that darkness, they're unwittingly feeding the darkness. Okay. But if you become too fascinated with the darkness, you know, then you're unwittingly feeding it too. But there's a third option, and the third option is to actually see the darkness. And then you see it, and then you can choose how you want to invest your attention. And then when you see it, you can choose, oh, I don't want to overly become fascinated and invest too much of my energy in that darkness. I want to invest my energy in creating this world I want to live in. You know, that's what's available to us. And that point of view is really the very perspective through which we actually dispel Wetiko and its toxic effects.
Absolutely. So this is sort of the becoming the dreamer, becoming the observer, becoming aware, and then dreaming the dream from a conscious awareness.
Right. It's very – exactly. That's so great that you would say that, because it's very much like being in a dream. The thing about Wetiko, it's a dreamed up phenomena. You know, and that's what in Buddhism they'll talk about, the nature of this reality is emptiness, that it doesn't exist from its own side. It has no intrinsic independent existence. The same thing with Wetiko. And one way of understanding that is, think about you're in a dream and you don't know you're dreaming, so you think it's real, just like the way a lot of us experience our lives. We think we actually, you know, that it has an objective existence. But in that dream, if you recognize simply the nature of the situation that you're in, i.e. that you're dreaming, which is to say that that you're inside of your own psyche, then all of a sudden you have lucidity, and all of a sudden your whole, the relationship that you have towards the forms of the dream totally changes, and that you realize, oh, there's nothing outside of myself. It's not objective. I don't have to unconsciously react. But who I'm discovering I am when I have that lucidity is, yeah, I'm both the forms of the dream. You have an expansion of identity, and I'm the dreamer. And then the question is, well, how do I want to dream the dream? You know, and that's what's available to us right now. Like, one way of understanding that, even to amplify it, is that if you are in a dream and you have lucidity and you've woken up, right, that's one thing. But then how about, and just invoke your imagination, what about if two people or 10 people or 100 people in that dream, other of your dream characters, aspects of yourself, if they also have lucidity and you come together and you connect with each other through what you're discovering, through that shared lucidity, what you realize is that, oh my God, this world we're in is a reflection of our own dreaming. It's a reflection of our own consciousness. And you discover we can, it's what I call our sacred power of dreaming. You could put that realization together and literally change the dream. And that's evolutionary. And that is what is available to us in our waking dream. And that's what Wetiko is showing us.
Absolutely. And doesn't it feel, though, that they're standing at the precipice of this, where humanity is waking up. We are understanding this aspect that you're describing as Wetiko, and have now the power to change it, to make a conscious decision to co-create our reality the way we want.
Yeah, that's where we're like at this, we're approaching this sort of an event horizon, one could say. And definitely, you know, we're at the point in the evolution of our species where more and more of us are recognizing, oh my God, the way I'll say it is that the universe is dreaming itself awake. And it's dreaming itself awake through us. And, you know, people who are like, oh, I'm expecting the Messiah to come, and I'm, you know, whatever, hoping or that the Messiah is going to come, I would point out that that's to miss the mark, which is the inner meaning of the word sin. The point is that we are the very Messiah that we're waiting for. And as more and more of us have that recognition, we can actually get in sync with each other and conspire. It's a phrase I use, conspire to co-inspire. It's a true conspiracy theory to breathe together, conspire to co-inspire, to activate our collective genius in a way where we can help other people to wake up. Because the more we help other people to wake up, but keep in mind there's no other people. When you wake up in a dream, you realize, oh, you've cut through that whole duality between self and other. So if I ask somebody, oh, if you recognize this is your dream, how would you dream it? How would you really unfold that dream? And, you know, what I would suggest to them is that anything other than a full and utter global awakening would be not satisfying, because who you've discovered you are when you wake up in a dream is that you're everyone. There's no separation anywhere. And that goes back to the non-locality, that there's not any sort of boundary or separation fundamentally, ultimately speaking, in this universe.
It's sort of an and in both. There's an individuality and a oneness that we're all a part of.
Yeah, no, that's a beautiful way of saying it, that having the oneness doesn't negate the multiplicity, that it's a both and, exactly.
Yeah, and there's another paradox of Wetiko, sort of existing within in human nature, yet not capable of existing independently. Can you talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, well, it's
30 de septiembre, a todos los números celulares de Ecuador, deberás agregarle 9 después.
What is that?
I think we might have lost Sienna, perhaps.
Yeah, well, we lost Sienna, but...
Should I answer that question, or...?
Yes, please.
Yeah, please.
So it's very much like, you know, if you have, like, say, a vampire can't exist on its own. It has to feed on somebody outside of itself in order to exist. Or, like think about like a virus can't just reproduce itself. It needs some other organism to pass itself on. And so, you know, it's a very interesting, it's not even an idea, because it's an actuality, that a thing like Wetiko, that it doesn't actually objectively exist, you know, separate from us. And like I was saying before, it operates through the psyche, through our unconscious blind spots. And but the one thing that it can't stand is it can't stand to be seen. Mm-hmm. Because when you see how it operates and that it doesn't have any intrinsic existence, then all of a sudden, by adding consciousness to it, you depotentiate it. You take away its omnipotence and its autonomy. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of why one of the things in the book, like I'm continually mapping the operations of Wetiko so that more and more people can see it. And in think about it, in like mythology, it's really important to find the name of the demon. When you find the name of a demon in any sort of fairy tale, you actually take away its power. And that's one of the things I'm trying to do with my new book, Dispelling Wetiko, is actually even just to introduce this word Wetiko more to the general public so that we actually have a name that's pointing at this seemingly formless, invisible sort of psychic germ that for as long as we don't see it, then it has power over us. But as soon as we mm-hmm. see it, then not only does it have no power over us, but then we become empowered.
Yeah, we turn our conscious awareness, the light of our consciousness on it, and exactly, it loses its power. I think it's important for folks not to get hung up here on whether or not Wetiko is, you know, caused by actual, you know, interdimensional entities, or is it byproduct of our splintered psyches, because, you know, either way, it's clear that humanity is affected with this, what you call psycho-spiritual disease of the soul, and I think it's just important to focus on understanding how it's able to function and how we become immune to it.
Yeah, no, totally. And the thing is, you know, because that's a really, from the philosophical point of view, that's an interesting question. Oh, is it like some sort of, you know, this negative extraterrestrial alien entity? Mm-hmm. Or is it just, you know, a split off part of ourselves? And when you think about, well, with the psyche, what has a reality to the psyche is what affects it, is what, you know, actually has an influence over it. And then the psyche takes it from there and will, how, you know, will unfold the effect. And the thing about Wetiko is that, you know, I can, you know, in the book I really go into, well, to say it objectively exists isn't true. To say it's just imagination isn't true. You know, if we just think, oh, I don't want to even think about Wetiko because it's not really real, well, guess what? Then we've fallen under the spell of Wetiko by doing that. But if we think it's real and objective, well, then we've fallen under the spell by doing mm-hmm. that. And that's showing us something. That's showing us something not only about the nature of Wetiko, but the nature of ourselves. Because the thing about Wetiko, it's funny, with most germs, you know, they actually, if you give them like antibiotics or something, they'll like, you know, go through like a mutation. Well, Wetiko, it forces us to mutate. It actually mm-hmm. forces us to evolve, or it will kill us. Okay? So it's really placing a demand, and it's a dreaming phenomena. I mean, it's just really, really obvious when you, you know, when you contemplate this world as a mass shared dream that we have all dreamed up Wetiko to play out. Because one of the things about Wetiko, its origin is the psyche, but it's non-local, which means the psyche is not just contained inside of our skulls, but the psyche expresses itself non-locally through the medium of the outside world. So Wetiko, whose origin is the psyche, actually configures events in the world to synchronistically express itself. And what that means is that, wow, you can recognize Wetiko by seeing what's happening in the world and having the recognition. That's a reflection of a process going on deep inside of ourselves.
Yeah. It's amazing. I mean, once you get this understanding, it's almost like game over for Wetiko.
Yeah, no, totally. Exactly. You know, yeah. And it's very much like being in a dream and seeing the nature of the dream, because dreams, the language of dreams are symbols. That's mm-hmm. that's how dream speaks. And so, you know, all of a sudden you begin to realize, oh, my God, everything that's it's like this universe is an oracle, which is speaking symbolically. It's an unfolding like this revelation and epiphany that's continually like just speaking through the language of symbols. Mm-hmm. And the thing about symbols, they don't exist objectively separate from the consciousness that's observing them. They're somehow like expressing something deep inside the psyche. So the whole question with Wetiko is whether we have the recognition of what it's revealing to us. Mm-hmm. And if we don't recognize what it's revealing to us, it's similar to like when we have a recurring dream, we're just going to dream up more and more of these nightmare scenarios, you know, in which we're really killing ourselves. Or if we have the recognition of what it's showing us, which is something in ourselves, our own shadow and our own light, then it, we can actually evolve and wake up to the dreamlike nature. And it all depends if we recognize what's being revealed.
And that's the beauty of it. I mean, that's it. It shows us exactly what's on the inside. So it really does serve for our evolution. I mean, it's serving us.
Yeah, no, it totally is. And but because it's not recognized, you know, it just like when you have a recurring dream, and if you don't recognize it, it recurs again and again in more amped up form, you know, until we mm-hmm. begin to recognize, oh, my God, it's like showing us something about ourselves. That's very much like Wetiko. So it really collapses the boundary between the inner and the outer.
It really does. I've noticed that in my own life. It's it grows. It will grow and grow and grow until you are forced to see it. And then you have no choice but to look at it.
Yeah. And I should just point out to what you just said. It goes back to that whole idea of like whether you see or whether you're blind. Because, you know, to the extent that we look away, our looking away from Wetiko is Wetiko. That's the way it plays itself out. And, you know, so I was talking about like with the blind woman or with the blindness of psychiatry, and that the thing about Wetiko, it's a psychic form of blindness. And what that's, you know, what all of that is pointing to is that, yeah, it feeds off of our, like, not seeing, mm-hmm. you know. And but to the extent that we actually begin to wake up and to see this, you know, this invisible, formless entity or bug or germ or virus or parasite or tapeworm, then all of a sudden you take away its power. Now, I should just say, if I can, the thing about Wetiko, one way to think about it, it's like a pathological part of the psyche that actually subsumes and begins to metastasize and take over and co-opt all of the healthy parts into its service so that, you know, at a certain point it begins to more and more colonize the psyche. And so there are all these, you know, types of Wetiko, but like when somebody becomes fully possessed, they could be said to be the incarnation of this higher-dimensional formless disease in human form. But by being that, they're actually revealing to us what this disease looks like. So somebody like with you know, whether it's with, you know, Bush, or just pick whoever you would think would be an embodiment of Wetiko, they're actually, by being the incarnation, they're actually, you know, showing us what the disease, what it looks like in through the form of a person, and particularly how the field around them. Think about Bush supporters way back when. People who were good people who were supporting Bush and following him, they were actually unwitting agents of the disease. The actual evil that was playing out through Bush couldn't have played itself out in such a powerful way without people supporting him. And that's showing the non-locality and the field effect of the disease.
Well, it shows how contagious it can be. Yeah, exactly. It spread. So what would you say to someone like who it gets taken over by Wetiko, even if it's just a one-off situation where your family sort of comes together and finds themselves completely taken over and the virus is protecting itself into the field? What can a person do in that situation?
Well, the interesting thing is, one of the things that you learn is that if you're seeing, you know, somebody or like a family or, you know, this whatever, like some sort of a group, and they're taken over by Wetiko, if you try to point that out to them, that's probably not going to go well, because when somebody's taken over by Wetiko, the last thing they want is to self-reflect and to actually see how they're actually, you know, being an instrument for evil, which is another way of describing what happens when somebody's taken over. So this is something I've fallen prey to a lot in my life, where I would like have the clear seeing of, oh, wow, this person is becoming an instrument for this darker energy, but I wouldn't have the skillfulness, and I would try to point out to them or convince them or explain to them. And then I would be the one who would be seen as being crazy or evil or whatever. So one, you know, there's something in Buddhism, they call it developing like, skillful means. So one way is to really embody that quality of kind of compassion and having some form of awareness. And just by embodying that, you energetically have some sort of effect on the other person and on the field itself. Mm-hmm. And keep in mind, this other way of like an immunization from the bug is to have the realization that it's something that we're all potentially susceptible to. When you have that realization, because think about it, who among us mm-hmm. has not fallen under, into their unconscious and unwittingly acted out their unconscious in a way that's destructive or hurtful on themselves or others. There's, you know, everybody's done that. Mm-hmm. When you realize that, you realize, oh my God, that actually creates like a humbleness in you, like you feel like a humility, and that's an inoculation against the germ.
I found that too. Yeah, and the love and gratitude that sort of fills that hole where the shadow aspect was at in your psyche. When you fill that hole up, then Wetiko has no place to be anymore. And again, then when you, when you encounter that, and when you encounter that in someone else, you have compassion and you can hold a sort of heart space because you've been there too.
right. No, absolutely. Yeah.
And so you actually hold the immunity for them. And like you said, it's energetic. But it is available.
Yeah, totally. And for me, one of the things that I'm trying to do with my work, you know, because there are so many more and more people who are beginning to wake up. Like, I'll just give you, like, I had a dream. This was the night before two of my teachers were coming to visit me. And I had this incredible dream where me and a whole group of people, we were trying to find this vampire. And we were all on the lookout for this Dracula figure. And we were actually chanting in the dream, Bela Lugosi, Bela Lugosi. And then I saw him. I see Dracula. And I try to point him out to other people. And there was no one else in the dream who could see him. I was the only one. And then I woke up. And I was realizing over the course of my life, oh, wow, I'm continuing that dream in my life, but now I've developed more and more of the fluency to be able to point out the vampire in a way that more and more people are able to see him. And as more and more of us are actually beginning to sniff the footprints of Wetiko and to get it more in focus and to see how it operates, not just out there, but through our own mind, you know, we can connect with each other through the energy of like this shared having like this, you know, shared like lucidity and compassion. And when you bring more and more people like that together, it really creates a field that can genuinely really help to dispel Wetiko.
And don't you find that as we do this work, even if we're not connected on a, let's call it a 3D level, we are affecting the field, so therefore it's out there, so people can sort of start to pick up on the immunity and start awakening in their own lives, even if they never even heard this conversation, never even were told about this concept, if you want to say. It is in the collective field, so it becomes available, sort of the 100th monkey.
That's so right on. I mean, just from what you're saying, it's so clear that you're really switched on to what I'm actually pointing at, because this beautiful image is like when you have sugar and you just put little grains of sugar in a glass of water, each grain of sugar will dissolve and dissolve and dissolve until you reach the point that's the saturation point. Mm-hmm. And then you add one more grain of sugar and a crystal will all of a sudden manifest. And that's sort of this way of understanding that any one of us, self-reflecting or, you know, owning our shadow or having the recognition of our dreamlike nature, you know, at any given moment, any one of us doing that might be that grain of sugar that, can totally mm-hmm. create a change in the entire collective unconscious of our species. And actually, I would say that that's a really good practice to imagine that at each and any moment that any of us are that grain of sugar that's doing that. And it points to, there's you know, the whole, like, non-local effect, you know, through the whole psyche or the collective unconscious. Mm-hmm. And, yeah, that's a really great thing to understand.
Yeah, that's beautiful. And so, again, it comes back to just doing our own inner work, focusing on our own shadow integration. As we focus on ourselves, it changes the collective.
Right, but then that's true, but there's a shadow part to that too, and I talk about this in my new book, because I talk about a figure, it's what I call a spiritually informed political activist, because I talk about people who are just spiritual practitioners who just feel like, oh, I'm just going to sit in my room and do my mantras and prayers and meditation, and then if I get all imbalanced, the whole you know, planet will be imbalanced. And there's truth to that, but it's also totally this like an expression of their like unconsciousness and like this whatever, just like sort of like this this narcissistic point of view, one could say, because what I mean is that when you recognize that this is the dream and you realize, oh my God, the way to work on my inner process is through the medium of the outside world, and that if I'm just focusing on my own internal process, that's the narcissism. So, you know, as a spiritual practitioner, we have to combine it with being politically active in the world. And the same shadow, or like a little bit of a different shadow, is in political activists who are like incredibly well-intentioned and trying to fight the evil. But if they're having anger or hatred or think the evil is separate from them, they're unwittingly feeding.
On your way through this hard venture, you will be tested.
This is the Truth Frequency Radio Network.
Welcome back, Shadowland Voyagers. Your experience, perception, and questions are deeply appreciated here. Join the conversation. Call in at 213-233-3998 or 888-832-2027.
Welcome back, everyone. This is hour two. We're here with Paul Levy, whose book, Dispelling Wetiko, Breaking the Curse of Evil, will be available in 2 days. Paul, I was deeply touched by your article on Sandy Hook. And just to start this second hour, I'll briefly read a paragraph about that and then turn over the interview process to my co-host, Elizabeth. The Sandy Hook Elementary School shooting of innocent, beautiful children, their heroic adult protectors, has touched something really deep within the sacred heart of humanity. Feel the tipping point has been reached. All states. I live in Portland, Oregon, where days before the Newtown massacre, there was a shooting in a local mall in which 2 people were killed. My first reaction upon hearing about the shooting was so many defenseless women and children were the combination of horror. At the same time, I find myself not surprised, as I had the thought, this is in the midst of collective psychosis. Our society, as well as our species, is suffering from a psychic epidemic of titanic proportions.
Sienna,
yes?
You're breaking up really intensely. Would you mind if I continue reading?
Please do.
Okay. This collective madness pervades the global body politic in such a way that it is hard to recognize because our madness is so obvious and has become so normalized that we don't even notice it anymore. A blindness, which itself is an expression of how advanced our madness has become. What happened in Newtown, in what has been called the safest town in America, is a symptom and expression of an underlying web of pathology that pervades not only our society, but the world at large. It is as if our civilization is having a collective nervous breakdown, in which this underlying dysfunction structures that are holding us together while at the same time obscuring the deeper collective madness are deconstructing, disintegrating, and coming apart at the seams. It is as if darker powers are materializing and becoming visible in our daily world, emerging through the cracks in the facade, as if our species is making a shamanic descent en masse into the underworld. Do you have anything to speak to that, Paul?
Oh, sure. You know that's
you wrote it, yeah.
I wrote it, so I was just appreciating the words, going, wow, that's pretty good. But what I was basically saying is that what's happening on the collective dimension is a reflection of what happens individually when one person potentially starts to have a shamanic process. At first, it almost always will appear as if they're having a breakdown. And what's happening is that their psyche is disintegrating towards a higher integration. And I'm saying, well, that individual process is what's happening collectively. And that our culture, our society, is having this mass nervous breakdown. And the structures that we've put in place that are actually symptoms and expressions of our madness and of our pathology are actually deconstructing and disintegrating, so that potentially, you know, something, you know, more something that's more an expression of our wholeness can you know, can come through. And you know, one of the things about the archetypal descent of the shaman is that it's always a descent into the underworld, into the unconscious, where they have to engage with the forces of darkness. And you know, if they get identified or absorbed, or they can get destroyed by those forces of darkness.
Welcome back to Shadowland Voyagers with Paul Levy. We were just discussing the Sandy Hook event that seems that Wetiko plays out as a collective mirror. Paul, you were discussing your thoughts on that in addition to the blog that you had posted, and I wanted to allow you some time to finish your thoughts on that.
Sure. So I was talking about that, you know, collectively we're making a descent, the archetypal shamanic descent, very much like an individual person would make, which involves making a descent into the unconscious and really confronting and coming to terms with sort of the darker forces. And one of the points that I make in my article on the Sandy Hook episode is that, well, what if we contemplated what happened as if it were a dream? And I'm not trying in any way to invalidate, you know, the horror of it, but to see it as if it's a dream is to see it symbolically, and to also have the recognition, well, I mean, I live in Portland, and the day of the Sandy Hook shooting was the day they opened the mall, the local mall, because two people had just gotten killed in a mall in Portland a couple days before. So that made me think, wow, it's like this is a recurring dream. And that when you have a recurring dream, and if you don't have the recognition of what it's showing to you, then you're ensuring that it's going to happen again and again in more amplified form. And so I was basically just saying, wow, the Sandy Hook shooting, something is getting revealed to us. Something is getting shown to us by what's playing out. And that's really where my attention went. You know, and that really has to do with viewing it as if it's a dream, viewing it symbolically. And that's a whole point of view that I just didn't find that it was being picked up in any of the media at all. So I felt a real responsibility to write the article.
Yes, and thank you for that, because these are the kinds of things that just get into an arena of debate and argument rather than taking it internally and looking at where, you know, there's complicity with certain aspects of what's being brought up, you know.
Yeah, and that whole idea of complicity, that's really totally important having to do with seeing Wetiko, because the thing about Wetiko, it's a field phenomena. And what that means is that we're all, in a sense, you know, it's just like dreamed up phenomena that we're all colluding and complicit with, to the extent that we're not aware of what's happening. And so, you know, the typical person, they just think of the world outside of themselves as separate, as objectively existing. And meanwhile, there's all this evil playing out in the world. And by them not having the recognition that it's a reflection of some sort of darkness inside themselves, they actually are complicit unwittingly, and are unwittingly feeding the very manifestation of evil that they think is outside of themselves. So it's really, really important to bring awareness to our own collusion and complicity with the evil that's playing out in the world.
Now, you know, I particularly enjoyed reading about how guilt plays a huge part in the shadow projection. guilt plays an intrinsic value to shadow projection.
I'd really like
you to discuss that.
Yeah. Sure. Because the thing is this, the thing about when somebody is really taken over by Wetiko is that in a way they have an unwillingness or an inability to consciously feel their own sense of guilt. And so, you know, one of the things that happens, and I think a lot of people can have the recognition of this, is when, you know, say if some of us are like recipient of somebody who's playing the role of an abuser, they might not feel consciously their guilt at all. But then we, for no reason, feel guilty. And it's almost like they've induced in us, who are maybe the recipient of the abuse, to feel the very feelings that they're unwilling or unable to feel themselves. And so the point is that one of the ways of really kind of an immunization with reference to Wetiko is for any of us, to the extent that we're consciously able to feel our shame and guilt and our sin. And I'm not saying that we're guilty, because to consciously feel our guilt is the doorway to getting in touch with the part of us that's fundamentally and ultimately innocent. But the extent of actually, you see, it's our guilt that won't allow us to feel our guilt, which secretly feeds what we feel guilty about in an infinitely regressing, negatively self-perpetuating feedback loop. So the point is that any of us, to the extent that we feel remorse of conscience, that actually can really help to heal us and to protect us from falling prey to the Wetiko bug.
I'll tell you, there's no nastier person than a guilty one. They will fight it to the death.
Right. Oh, totally.
And then also, you talked about the typical prey of Wetiko, like what the typical personality type is, which is someone not in touch with their inner guidance and things like that.
Yeah, totally. Somebody who's not in touch with their inner guidance or not in touch with themselves or is open to just like opinions of other people. So when you're not really connected with yourself, you see, then you actually are in a way in an open, you know, sort of channel for Wetiko to inhabit. And one thing about Wetiko, you see, it's a higher dimensional bug or virus, however you want to describe it, and it will shapeshift and literally assume your form and will put you on as if it's putting on a suit of clothes. So, and if you're not aware in that moment, you will then identify with that identity and think it's you, or that thought form or that emotion or whatever that Wetiko inspired thought or feeling. And then you'll just assume, oh yes, I'm just acting on my own impulses or acting on my own thoughts, but it's actually an imposter of yourself, almost like you're impersonating yourself. And that's how Wetiko, you know, will operate. And it's very interesting when you really contemplate this, because psychologically there's something, Jung called them an autonomous complex. And autonomous complexes are split off parts of the psyche based on maybe having trauma, that because they're split off, they develop a seemingly quasi-independent life and will of their own. And the indigenous people, what they would refer to autonomous complexes as, they would call them demons. And what I'm describing as an autonomous complex or a demon, that's exactly what Wetiko is. You could say it's a split-off part of our wholeness, of the wholeness of our psyche, that then will seemingly develop, you know, this other independent will of or life of its own. And then if we don't have the meta awareness, we'll then unconsciously identify with it, and then we become the instrument through which it enacts itself and incarnates into the third dimension. Okay.
And from that point on, all the actions are justified, and so there's not really any taking responsibility at that point. It's all justified and makes perfect sense, right?
Well, from that point of view, one way to understand that is that when you're in a dream and you hold, like I was saying before, you hold a particular point of view in the dream, well, what will the dream do? The dream being, you know, what the dream is a reflection of your own mind. So if you hold a viewpoint in the dream will supply all the evidence and all the justification you need to support that particular point of view. And then, so if you're not recognizing what's actually playing out, then you feel, oh, now I have all the objective evidence I need to really prove the rightness of my point of view. So you even become more entrenched in that perspective, which means the more entrenched you are, the more then the evidence will be supplied, and it becomes a feedback loop that will actually support you in your own psychosis. And that's one way. You see, there are infinite ways in my new book that I try to articulate, you know, the operations, the covert operations of Wetiko, you know, because as we more and more get turned on to them, we more and more become free of it, you know?
Right. Absolutely. Now, you also discuss creating a hermetic vessel and like a frame of reference for self-observation. Can you discuss this a bit?
Sure. And a hermetic vessel, it's an alchemical term. And another simple way of describing it, it's a container. And the thing about a hermetic vessel is that, so inside of it is what's called the prima materia. The prima materia is like the stuff that needs to be transformed. It's the raw, you know, primal matter, the chaos that typically can be shadowy and dark and seemingly evil. And so think about it, if we, like with myself, I can talk about my own process. When I was first traumatized by my father's illness, you know, and it created this wound in me, for a long time I was like, oh, rats, if only I didn't have this wound, I would be all enlightened, right?
Right.
But then I began to realize, no, the wound is my way to becoming enlightened.
Yeah.
That's, you know, that's what I need, and that's the prima materia. Now, going back to the hermetic vessel, like typically it's portrayed underneath the hermetic vessel is fire. And that's the fire of, like, consciousness that actually will transmute and transform the prima materia. But the hermetic vessel has to be sealed. It has to be airtight. Think about a hermetic vessel. It's an airtight vessel. And so that's symbolizing that nothing gets sort of projected outside. And there's going to create enormous pressure with it being sealed and with the fire underneath. But it's only if there's enough pressure will the prima materia transform into the gold, which is the enlightened mind. And so the point is that we have to cultivate in our own self a hermetic vessel, and we can hang out with each other and configure ourselves with reference to each other and get in phase with each other and get in sync with each other in a way where we actually create that hermetic vessel through our being in relationship, through our actually recognizing, wow, we're having a mass shared dream, which means you're a dream character in my dream and I'm a dream character in your dream. What that also means is that whatever's playing out, we're all dreaming up together. That awareness, that point of view is the hermetic vessel. That cultivates the hermetic vessel. And that's the sort of the point of view that will actually transform the lead, the prima materia. And interesting, the lead, one of the analogies for that is the negative patriarchy, is the negative father, which from the mythological point of view is the myth that plays out through Wetiko. Because the negative father, it like actually will actually act out abusing power simply because it can. That's in a way what the negative patriarchy is all about. That's the might makes right attitude of the military industrial complex. So all that I'm describing about the inner workings of Wetiko is getting explicated and expressed through the actual medium of the outside world, through our shadow government, through our freedoms being taken away. All of that is what's showing when Wetiko, when it actually begins to colonize the psyche, that's exactly what it does inside an individual psyche, and it's actually getting reflectively played out in the outer world.
So, in other words, the idea is to step out of that victim mentality and actually see the necessity of the dramas that are played out in life as a map to our own healing.
Yeah, right. And the thing is, when you see the dramas that are being played out in our life and you recognize synchronistically, oh my God, they're actually these external scenarios are reflecting back synchronistically something that's happening deep inside my own psyche. You see, that's like when I talk about the non-locality, that, you know, it's easy to see. The thing about evil, when you see it out there, it's impossible to see evil without something evil being ignited in your own psyche. In the same way that when you see the unconscious, when you see somebody acting out the unconscious, it triggers your unconscious. It's non-local, right?
Yeah.
And then it all depends. Are you able to metabolize what's gotten triggered inside of you. And then if you are able to do that, then you can actually be of help to the seeming darkness outside of yourself. So the same way, when you see evil out there, with reference to that non-locality, you actually then have an opportunity to really to integrate and to assimilate the evil that's gotten activated in you by the very seeing of it outside. And if you're able to do that and integrate that darkness and that shadow into your own wholeness, then you're actually able to be an agent of positive change in the world.
And that would lead me to the next thing, which is you talk about the artist. And I'd like you to maybe touch on that a bit, too.
Sure. No, totally. Well, as an artist, this is something very close to my heart.
Yeah.
And basically what I talk about, you see, the thing about Wetiko is that it's a semantic disorder. It has to do with how we create language and have meaning on our experience. And when you think about – and the thing about Wetiko, it doesn't easily lend itself to words because it's, kind of this formless, invisible, hard to pin down thing. And the idea being that when we actually meet evil, think about it, when somebody becomes a victim of some form of abuse, they get fractured inside between their experience and their ability to form words and to actually creatively find the language for their experience. They become fragmented, where mm-hmm. it's very hard for them to find the words. Well, the thing about art is that, particularly with Wetiko, it literally will force you to more and more find your voice. And interestingly, etymologically, the voice is related to one's to the vocation, to the one's calling, to the genius, genie, I Dream of Genie, the old TV show, and to what's called the daimon. And the daimon is the inner voice or the guiding spirit, right? And so the point being is that if you connect with your daimon, then you'll find your genius and your genie and your calling and your inner voice and vocation. But if you turn away from the daimon, it becomes negative and becomes demonic. It becomes a demon. Now, interestingly, Jung defined the daimonic. Now, the daimonic is a higher dimensional archetypal energy that can literally take over a person or a group of people, and then they become an instrument through which this higher dimensional daimonic energy acts itself out. But getting back to the definition of the daimonic, Jung defined the daimonic as the not yet made real creative. The idea being that encoded in the daimonic energy of Wetiko is the creative spirit. So if you're able to find not just words, but create, but access the creative spirit in you and create art and symbolize your experience and creatively express it, that actually is in the service of dispelling Wetiko. Okay, so one of the things that I really focus on in my book is the profound importance for any of us of really connecting with our true nature as creative artists and these dreamers. And our canvas is this universe. Okay, so it's profoundly important for each of us to find our voice and to step in to the part of us that's a creative spirit and is, an artist.
Yeah, because I've noticed that as I go through this process of integrating these shadow aspects, that I'm able to like more fully engage with life and enter what you're talking about, this conscious co-creation with life, and definitely finding my voice and just being really truly alive, like finally alive, awake in the dream.
Yeah, no, that's exactly the way it works. And when somebody like whether it's with one person or a number of people. To the extent that we connect with that place in ourselves that is alive and that we are cultivating our soulfulness and our empathy, and part of that is also having the recognition that we're not separate, that we're interconnected and interdependent, that is the very stance that in a way, dispels like the toxic effects of Wetiko. Because the thing about Wetiko, it operates through a fragmented psyche. If the psyche is whole and has the recognition of our interconnectedness, then there's no place for Wetiko. There's no place for Wetiko to actually grow.
Awesome. Going to break. We'll be right back.
We'll be right back.
Welcome back, Sienna Levy. And this is our final half hour with Paul Levy. Paul, I wanted to read a bit from an excerpt from Dispelling Wetiko here and discuss this with you, if I may. Okay. The greatest protection against becoming negatively affected and in extreme cases possessed by the evil aspects of Wetiko is to be in touch with our intrinsic wholeness, which is to be self-possessed. In self-possession of the part of ourselves that is not possessable, which is the self, the wholeness of our being, we truly defeat evil when we connect with the part of ourselves that is invulnerable and cannot be vanquished by it. How do we become that wholeness, Paul?
Sure.
I know we've talked about it from a number of ways, but I wanted to hit it from that angle.
Yeah, no, I really appreciate that. Because I guess the first thing I should point out is that people who are fighting against evil, they've already, by fighting against it, they've already lost. You know, they've, in a way, subscribed to the duality intrinsic to evil. And so what I'm saying is that the way to defeat evil is by finding in oneself the place that's transcendent to it or invulnerable to it. And that's the true nature state. And, you know, so, for example, my sense is that any spiritual practice of any tradition, it's ultimately about the same thing. It's having that recognition, whether you call it our Christ nature or Buddha nature, it just doesn't make a difference. And it's that part of us that's already free. And it's that part of us, think about like when you have sort of like this mirror. If you have a mirror, even the vilest reflections don't taint or stain the mirror. And as a matter of fact, the actual reflections point to the mirror. You couldn't see the mirror without the reflections. So, you know, what that's pointing at is that, you know, with the seeming evil and the darkness that's seemingly obscuring our true nature is itself an expression of the true nature. And when you begin to recognize that, you begin to realize, oh my God, everything, every moment, even the points and the moments when I feel the most separate from myself or from God or the most contracted, you know, self-contracted against myself, even those moments, instead of obscuring my true nature, are in some odd way the expression of my true nature. You begin to recognize that each moment is just that, is the unmediated expression of our true nature. Then all of a sudden, you more and more are able to stabilize that realization. Now, what I'm describing, it's very analogous to being in a dream and having the recognition that you're in a dream and having lucidity. It's not hard to do that for an instant, but then it's very easy to get absorbed back into the forms of the dream and to forget that you're dreaming. In the same way, it's not that hard to have the recognition of your true nature, but really what the practice is to more and more stabilize that so that you don't get distracted. And on top of that, that everything that manifests, even the seemingly obscuring energies, are recognized to be the actual manifestation or expression pointing at our true nature, then everything becomes subsumed into that realization. And that's when you really become like a full-blown embodied agent, you know, of positivity and healing for the world. And so that I have a whole, like what you read was the beginning paragraph of a whole section towards the end of the book where I really talk about, you know, how to really, what Wetiko was showing us and how to really heal from it. And it really involves connecting with the truth of who we are.
Yes. And in this last half hour, I would love our listeners to hear any practical. Now, I know that you studied Buddhism and Vipassana, I believe. And I wonder if you could share with our listeners any kind of practices that they can actually do to achieve the state of witnessship and this level of awareness that you're talking about.
Sure. Well, and that's, keep in mind, that's quite a question because that's...
I know. But yeah, something, yeah.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. No, I appreciate that. And I guess one thing... Because, you know, okay, I'll just answer it this way. when I first began having these dreams in which I was having recognition that I was dreaming and had lucidity, spontaneously I began chanting a mantra, and the mantra was Om Mani Padme Hung. And I was such a beginning practitioner, I wasn't even doing that particular practice, and I didn't even know that that practice, those six syllables, Om Mani Padme Hung, that's the mantra of compassion. And so I found it interesting that as I was having lucidity, which from Buddhist point of view is to recognize the emptiness meaning there's nothing intrinsic or independently existing separate from your own mind, at the same moment I was having the realization of emptiness, which is the lucidity, I was chanting the mantra of compassion. Now, I didn't realize at the time, and this began happening again and again and again. What I didn't realize was that in Buddhism, they talk about when you have true awakening, it's always the combination of two factors, of emptiness and compassion. So here in my dreams, I was recognizing the emptiness and chanting the mantra of compassion. So people, when they ask me, oh, how can I wake up in the dream? How can I like become more lucid? One of the ways of doing that, a very real and powerful way, is to cultivate compassion. Because as you're cultivating compassion, if it's real compassion, it's actually in the service of actually cultivating the realization of emptiness and of lucidity. So in whatever way one can do that, and the way I'll do it, I chant Om Mani Padme Hung. It's a practice I do every day. But even, you know, in addition to that, when I recognize that this is this mass shared dream that we're all in right now, and I recognize, oh my God, we're all each other's dream characters. Like, I'm a dream character of all of you guys. You've, like, dreamed me up to say whatever I'm saying, but I'm dreaming all of you up to dream me up. It's not a linear causal loop. It's an acausal, atemporal loop that is the nature of the co-dreaming. What you discover is that, oh, wow, we're actually, by being dream characters in each other's dreams, we're interconnected, interdependent, we're not separate. All of those insights are in service of deepening and cultivating our compassion, which is ultimately in the service of connecting with our true nature and attaining lucidity. So compassion is really the key. But I should warn, this one sort of shadow element to that, and I want to make a distinction between what some traditions call sort of, they'll say there's idiot compassion, which is sort of smiley-faced and patting each other on the back. That's not the true compassion. In the sense that sometimes compassion can be really fierce and really set a boundary and say no. So it's really important, you know, to cultivate that sense of compassion. That, I think, is really the answer to your question.
So there's a very deep place that you're holding as you move in the inner and the outer world, this integration of the shadow, the integration of your loving heart puts you, it appears to me, in a deep place of consciousness that is beyond duality, that you're actually, I can't imagine being able to realize this unless you're aware of the polarity in yourself and everything existing around you all the time, that this is the great awakening. This is, some of us are calling that the dimensional shift into the fifth dimension. The ascension process is in this non-dualistic reality, and it seems to be pointing as solution to this whole thing. That if we continue to polarize our perception of other people, we talk about judging other people, we talk about looking at, I know does all the time, the right and the wrong and good and the bad, and she's in or she's out, or she's, we're doing it all the time. And it doesn't seem we can be effective in transmuting this evil if we stay in that state, no matter whether we're the great do-gooders, the great love and lighters, and on their white horses, and we carry evil. And I mean, there's such a mass polarization right now we're seeing.
Yeah, no, totally. And it's that polarization that's the signature of the disease, of the pathology of Wetiko. That's exactly it. And you see, one of the things that I continually contemplate in my new book, again and again, there's something called the coincidentia of oppositorum, the coincidence of opposites. And you get to the point where the opposites not only become indistinguishable, but you begin to realize, well, in some sense, it's not even like they're joining together, but they're actually inseparably one. And that's not able to be understood from the typical, like, two-valued, like, there's a logic where, well, things are either good or bad or right or wrong. There's a whole higher dimensional form of, like, this logic that I introduced in the book that's a Tibetan Buddhist logic. It's a four-valued logic. And it's a more logic in alignment with the our one's wholeness, one could say. And it totally cuts through any sort of polarization or like sort of like the dualistic thinking. And when you more and more see that, and the only way to see that is to be that, is to more and more, you know, tap into that place in yourself that is your own wholeness. Now, the thing to remember about our wholeness, it's not like we have to first attain it or create that. We already are that. We just don't recognize it, you know? And that's the thing. That's, in essence, like I do hours of practice a day, and that's one way of describing it, because I feel I'm still a beginning practitioner, but I'm beginning more and more. I have like a little bit of familiarity with that true nature part of me, and I'm more and more just, you know, trying to stabilize and to become familiar with that place in myself that is whole. And I don't have to, like I said, create it, like in the same way or attain it. Like I don't have to attain my body or my attain my feet. No, I already have my feet or my body. I just have to actually to have the recognition of it, that it or that it already and always exists, and just to not get distracted from that. And that's, in essence, that's really the most fundamental way of describing spiritual practice.
Wouldn't it be helpful if we engaged in this kind of practice as community? You talk about a field. You talk about the field, and right now it's mainly dominated by the virus, by the Wetiko. But if we consciously came together in principles of compassion and non-dualistic action and service to self and others, and we could we not create a field that would support each one of us to step into this and hold this frequency, this understanding?
You're exactly right. I mean, where I live, you know, I have all throughout the week these groups of people, and I call them Awakening in the Dream groups. And they're people who are waking up to the dreamlike nature. And we're all coming together, you know, three, four nights a week. And we just inquire into the nature of our experience together in the moment without any agenda. And but all based on this understanding that we're having a mass shared dream, that we're dream characters in each other's dream, that we're not separate. And there's incredible power. You know, even the historical Shakyamuni Buddha talks about the three jewels, the three supports of enlightenment, the Buddha, Dharma, Sangha, the teacher, teaching, and community. And he actually said, yeah, one of the supports of enlightenment is an enlightened community. When you actually have other people who are also awakening, who can support each other in their awakening. And interestingly, the word bodhisattva, my favorite translation of the word, is a being in the process of awakening. And who among us is not that? And so when you bring people together with that intention, it creates, talk about a non-local field that's potentiated for healing. And but the thing to remember, when you have an intention to wake up and to transduce light, you're guaranteed going to invite a guest, and the guest is the unconscious. And the unconscious will actually act itself out in a shadowy way through whoever at that moment is most susceptible to falling asleep. But instead of that being necessarily problematic, when there's a community that's turned on to the wiles of Wetiko, that itself, that shadow acting out, becomes the portal or the doorway to deepen our understanding of Wetiko and of ourselves. So it actually can stimulate our lucidity even further.
Yes, I would really like to have access to our listenership and the world in general to the practices, the formats that you're using. I don't spread this. I mean, I'm just feeling this just needs to be spread worldwide, because my experience of building community, which I've been trying to do since the 70s, is it's always train wrecked by the Wetiko.
Exactly. There'll be like shadow projection or gossip or like polarization or like power plays. You know, and you know, just with one thing I should say about these circles, I'm not in the ordinary role of teacher. I'm just one of the circle. And yeah, it's my vision and I get paid for it. It's what I do for a living. But I'm also like, I get as much in my unconscious or as much triggered as anybody else. And then when I get triggered, I can't facilitate. So then somebody else picks up the role of facilitator, and you begin to realize, oh, my God, we're all just picking up all the different roles in an equal way. There's not a hierarchy. Like, I'm the teacher. That would make other people students. We're all like the teacher, and we're all helping each other to awaken. And that's, in a way, that's like, you know, sort of this new paradigm, stepping out of any sort of hierarchy or separation or power play.
That's interesting. We created this show on that basis. I was doing a show by myself, and Christina and Elizabeth, we all connected, and we realized that simultaneously we wanted to hold a field and of equality and a shared energy, and that and bringing people such as you on and share in that field, and that the very nature of holding that field would create a frequency. Would be valuable just for that sake.
Yeah, totally. And that I just want to say too, if you guys are doing that or with my groups, it's what I call this microcosmic fractal. That in other words, it's actually that's when you see it symbolically, even if it's happening with like, you know, 10 people in say in my house, that's like, you know, a symbol that's actually showing us what's potentially we can access through all 7 billion of us. You know, and that any of us, even two of us doing that and kind of configuring ourselves so that we're stepping out of our separate ego, that's actually like people were saying before with the 100th monkey phenomena, that's in a non-local way instantaneously getting like registered all throughout the field of consciousness.
It's so great because so many of us feel so disempowered, even though we're aware that self empowerment is the name of what's up for us evolutionarily. Still seeing, you know, Sandy Hook and just the horrible desecration and huge pain and suffering of humanity that we in many ways feel powerless to do anything about. It's so encouraging to know that doing this kind of work, and we all agree with here at Dispelling Voyager, there's a huge potency to it. It may not look like anything's happening. You know, we may not be getting hundreds of thousands of people listening to the show, for example, but it doesn't matter. We're just persisting week after week after week. And we may, in fact, have a lot more potency than anyone realizes. And everyone out there can do the same thing to come together with these kinds of groups. Are you going to, at some point, with your Wetiko, have a workbook or can you like clone yourself and go viral around the planet?
It's funny you say that because for so many years, the people in my groups, we've been trying to figure out how to get this work out more on the global stage and particularly about the groups. But there's only, you know, I'm only one person. And so it's funny you say about like the emanation, you know, these multiple emanations because, yeah, people who want to fly me out to, you know, to do a group. And I say, well, you should really fly me and about 5 of my friends out because if I'm facilitating a group and if I get triggered and if there's nobody there who knows really what we're doing with like the whole, you know, awakening of the dream technology, then, you know, it can be a disaster. But when you have other people, you know, like, and so it could be because there are people in the groups for 15 years, 12 years, 10 years. I feel that there are people who are really getting trained in this work. But if I can just say one thing, too, about the feeling disempowered, because I know that so many people feel helpless or disempowered or have pessimism. And if we're actually identified with that point of view of feeling pessimistic or helpless or not in our power, we're actually feeding Wetiko because then we see our experience of the world through the lens of pessimism, which being like a dream, then we'll supply all the evidence to support our pessimism, which then, like I described before, in an infinitely self-perpetuating, you know, self-created feedback loop will then even more concretize us in our pessimistic point of view. And it just goes on and on. And so it's really important to understand it's one of the dangers is to get absorbed in despair or pessimism or feeling disempowered or helpless. But to understand that there are so many of us who are awakening and it can be you and me. We can, you know, any one of us could be, like I was saying, that grain of sugar, you know, that with that it gets to that saturation point where there's a change in the entire consciousness of our species based on any one person having the recognition. So the point is that, you know, there are so many of us who are awakening that can really uplift us and make us feel in touch with a positive energy and feel alive and awake. and to express ourselves creatively and authentically, all of that, Wetiko can't stand that, you know. And so to do that, to be authentic and to be in our power and creative, to find our voice and to not get absorbed in any sort of disempowered state, all of that is in the service of really to break the spell of the evil of Wetiko.
Oh, it's beautiful.
Beautiful.
I think the other thing I'd like to bring attention to is that I often hear people talk about getting attacked astrally or what have you, and sort of feeling that helplessness, like, oh, it's happening to me. And it's really important to turn the corner on that and become self-empowered. And again, like you're saying, just really start to cultivate that compassion for yourself, within yourself and others, so that you can rise above that feeling of being attacked and use it for your towards your advantage, to find out what part of you is susceptible to that attack. Where did that come from? Because it's not just going to come at you out of nowhere. If you're immune to it, it can't attack you. Wetiko has no place in.
Right. And the one way I describe that in my new book, I say, for example, two of my spiritual teachers, these great, they're from Tibet, and they're these great monks and lamas, and they were giving an empowerment, this blessing ceremony, which was going to heal any sort of black magic. That was the particular empowerment they were giving. And they just, when they were giving the blessing ceremony, they said, this actually won't dispel black magic, because black magic doesn't even objectively exist. But if you believe there's black magic, and if you believe you're susceptible to black magic, this empowerment and blessing will dispel that belief, because you believing that there's something that can harm you, that's the very point of view that opens the door for Wetiko to come in. It's the actual belief of our being, susceptible in a certain way. But of course, they're talking about, from the absolute ultimate point of view of the true nature, where the true nature is invulnerable, in the same way that mirror isn't tainted or stained by any of the reflections. But I want to point out, from the point of view of the relative reality, you see, it's important to really understand there's the relative reality where we really have to protect ourselves, and there is some sort of polarization. And then there's the ultimate reality, which is transcendent to any sort of duality at all. But the two interpenetrate. They're not separate, But a lot of people make a mistake. They hear about the ultimate absolute level of reality, and they just identify with that, and they don't deal with all of the relative reality, and that's the big mistake.
Yeah, that's so true. Spiritual activism is a huge part of what we can do, and we're deer in the headlights in the middle of all this. We're just going so inward. That isn't the wholeness you're talking about. That isn't the transcendent aspect. That isn't our power at all.
Yeah, no, totally. And the thing is like, that's in ultimately what our responsibility is, that each one of us to connect with that intrinsic wholeness, and to really, really stabilize that. And then we become like a carrier or an embodiment or an incarnation of that, which non-locally really affects the field. And I see this when I'm around my teachers. It is amazing to see, because they're so integrated and so authentic and just embodying this state of lucidity.
Paul, we need to get you back on. Give us your information. How do they get the book? How do they find you? We're just coming on to the end here too quickly.
Sure. So, it's coming out on Tuesday, the 15th of January. They can go to my website, awakenintheDream.com is the website. AwakenIntheDream.com, or they can just go to Amazon or any places that sell books all over the planet. We'll have my book, Dispelling Wetiko, as of Tuesday.
Beautiful. It was wonderful having you. We'd really love to have you again. This is just such a fascinating topic. Thank you for being such a trailblazer for us all. You're an incredibly amazing soul. So inspiring. I feel like I've gotten so much just learning from you tonight. Thank you so much.
I really appreciate that. It's been my pleasure. Thank you so much.
Good night. 10,000 people. Check it.
People talking without speaking. People hearing without listening. People
for writing songs that voices never share. No one did disturb the sound of silence. Fool said, I, you do not know. Silence like a cancer grows. Hear my words that I might teach you. Take my arms that I might reach you. But my words, like silent raindrops, fell. Echoing the wind of silence. And the people bowed and prayed to the neon god they made. And the sign flashed out its warning in the words that it was forming. And the sign said the words of the prophets are written on the subway walls. The tenement.